In this secret laboratory deep down in the bowels of the earth, this man carries out his fiendish research.
Is it safe?
Clear! But I'm gonna torture you anyway.
Hey, that didn't hurt, did it?
You can't let a man die so that you can discover something?
Doctor, he's gone.
Oh my God, don't stop now!
Well, time for me to do another physical. This time I'm going to dig deep and I won't stop till I get to the bone. Don't worry, I'm a doctor. My name is John Woolscroft and this is another edition of The Check-In. Let's see who our patient is today. The Silence of the Lambs. Goddammit Jim, I'm a doctor, not a veterinarian!
But seriously, kids, this film was met with a lot of backlash from Queer Nation and ACT UP from the outset. They even threatened to disrupt the most important night of the year for ego-driven millionaires and enthusiasts of naked gold man statues, the Academy Awards.
So let me put my many fanciful medical degrees to the test as I plunge into the dank, moist corridors of this issue to see what all the fuss is about. Now, right off the bat, I do want to point out that this is one of my favorite movies growing up. Yes, growing up, I didn't have a very normal childhood. And still continues to be one of my favorite flicks to this day. But upon more recent viewings, it does have some issues. Most, if not all of them, having to deal with Buffalo Bill. No, not that one, that's Bungalow Bill. No, that's Billy Bush, another medical emergency. But we'll get to that eventually. No, I'm talking about this guy. Best thing about that is never going to be flattering if you have to turn around. Let's take a look at how this film deals with being psychotic, and whether or not this man is or is not transgender on top of being psychotic. We even have to deal with this in a 1991 setting, which, as a point of reference very quickly, this was the depiction of AIDS that we had growing up.
Hey, what's he doing here? He's not gonna infect my players! Get him out of here! He's got AIDS!
But hey, just like Ronald Reagan, we didn't come here to talk about AIDS or think about AIDS or do anything about AIDS. This is more about an analysis of Silence of the Lambs. So we join Clarice in her cheap shoes and gaudy handbag as she is entrusted to talk to the brilliant and perpetually hungry Dr. Hannibal Lecter. She is on the big Buffalo Bill case to figure out why he keeps walking out on the check at Buffalo Wild Wings. It's why he's kidnapping, skinning, and murdering young women. I have to stop messing up those charts.
Clarice starts exploring the disappearance of Benjamin Raspill. Ben can be seen here enjoying a swim. Clarice rejoins Dr. Lecter after her, let's say, less than enjoyable first meeting.
It's actually things like that that don't allow me to host Thanksgiving any longer. But during this second meeting, we get the first use of the big T word.
Need millions of dollars buried under a big T!
No, not that one.
If you didn't kill him, then who did, sir?
Who can say? Best thing for him, really. His therapy was going nowhere.
His dress... makeup. Raspo was a transvestite?
First off, Clarice, according to the DSM, it's transgender now, not transvestite. The only time that it's okay to use that is in this situation.
I'm just a sweet transvestite.
Oh, and apparently also according to the DSM, I'm not supposed to call you Hick, but salt of the earth.
In life? Oh no. Garden variety manic depressive.
So it would seem that this film is trying to skirt around any controversy by avoiding calling this guy transgender in any way, but that he's actually just nuts instead. And yes, nuts is a clinical term.
In the new comedy, Mixed Nuts.
The significance of the moth is change. Caterpillar into chrysalis or pupa, and from thence into beauty. Our belly wants to change too.
This is one of the few positives we can actually give to this film in terms of the characterization of Buffalo Bill. That he's not actually a member of the transgender community, but just somebody who's deeply, deeply troubled and needs mental help. So I think it's fair to say that the 1991 audience, who up until now only had a handful of experiences of trans people in film, such as...
The body of the woman within begins to appear now. The world is shocked by a person who changed his sex. Thus, the strange case of Glenn, who was Glenda, one and the same person.
And...
Put him down! Put him down! Put those fucking guns down! Put those guns down! Out of the cars! Out of the cars!
Both brave and accurate portrayals, of course.
There's no correlation in the literature between transsexualism and violence. Transsexuals are very passive.
Thank you for bringing up that random stat, Clarice. Here are a few of my own.
Transgender characters were cast in the victim role at least 40% of the time in TV and film. Transgender characters were cast as killers or villains in at least 21% of cataloged episodes and storylines. The most common profession for transgender characters were that of sex workers, which fifth of all characters were depicted as 20%. Anti-transgender slurs, language, and dialogue were present in at least 61% of the catalog episodes and storylines. So in all my years of deep medical research, i.e. the medical research I did 40 minutes last night without the TV on, I mean, in medical school, I can't decide if this is a step in the right direction by the movie or not. Is it negative? Is it suggesting that anybody who has inklings of transgender feelings will try to skin heavyset women to make the worst winter line ever in the history of New York Fashion Week? Or is it saying that actual transgender people would not behave in this way? I do feel that the film goes towards the latter, thankfully. But considering the gender identity question we had at the turn of the decade, they can so easily be overlooked. Or, by a completely ignorant audience, could just assume that the guy was gay instead, which has literally nothing to do with anything.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
We were so naive back then. Remember, this is before the great Surge Wars of 1996. We were so young.
There are three major centers for transsexual surgery: Johns Hopkins, the University of Minnesota, and Columbus Medical Center.
That's true. Johns Hopkins does do that. That's one of the universities where I got one of my many degrees in animal husbandry. What? Deal with it.
Billy hates his own identity, you see, and he thinks that makes him a transsexual. But his pathology is 1,000 times more savage.
Oh boy. So Lecter is charming, brilliant, and even likable to a degree. The individual who has been lumped in with the transgender community, however, is more batshit goofy tunes than six possums on meth and acid thrown into a piss-soaked sack in a funhouse. At least that's how my grandmother used to say it. And that's not a good thing. I pointed out that I don't think the film is suggesting that this character is actually transgender. But the problem is that when you live in a world full of lack of proper education on gender identity, they're going to assume that anybody who has a gender identity different than the sex organs they were born with is going to be somehow dangerous or mentally defective or a danger to them or their loved ones, which simply is not the case. The problem is the ignorance of the audience, and this film does not do a good enough job of separating actual transgender people from psychopaths. If they just kill people, they would be called nuts. But because it involves things of a sexual nature, we look for an easy label, like gay or trans, even if the film tries to distance itself from it. I do think time has really put this movie into proper context, with the more educated society has become. It could be very easily viewed as troublesome when it came out, but thankfully we know not to label Bill as anything but crazy these days, and that he is not in any way, shape, or form a representation of the trans community.
Remember, in 1991, we thought OJ was a great father, that Umbros were acceptable, that MC Hammer was going to control the airwaves forever. But now we need to look at Silence of the Lambs with a more critical and thoughtful eye. I'm giving this one a pass, but on thin ice, because we've come so far. Don't worry, though. I am writing a prescription for the pain.
And you don't know what pain is!
All right, I'll double it. Jeez.